Reynolds. I am with a project called Nevermind. It's a biofeedback enhanced horror game. I've actually done 4 Kickstarters for it. We did 1 Indiegogo Kickstarter back in, 2012. Nevermind started as an MFA thesis project at USC. And so back then we did a small crowdfunding campaign just to get finishing funds for it. At USC you don't really have any budget to work on the projects that you're working on. So and with a biofeedback game you have to buy sensors and a lot of R&D equipment. So but a very small campaign then to help with that, and it was great. We then did another one 6 months later to help support us submitting Nevermind to various festivals. Again, sensors are really expensive. And so when you don't have any budget for the project, you need a little help. And so it was great. We had great support that really helped us get it out there. And that enabled me to leave my full-time job at the time and work on Nevermind full-time. So we did another Kickstarter. This is the one that Nevermind's probably most well-known for, back in February to March, last spring. And it was a great success in that we had all of this amazing support and enthusiasm, and it was great because we discovered that this is not just some crazy idea that I think is cool, other people out there think is cool, which is great. We didn't hit our goal though, so we didn't get funded there, but Nevermind actually got funding through Intel, and which has helped us continue with the project on a small scale. And as of yesterday, it feels like forever, we launched a new one that's going to help us expand Nevermind out from just the PC-only version to other platforms like Mac, Xbox One, Oculus Rift, be able to develop for more sensor types so that hopefully if you have a heart rate sensor of any kind, it'll work with the game, as well as build more content, more levels, because right now we're only 5 to build 3, but we're hoping we can build more. So I've kind of seen a lot of different Kickstarter, Indiegogo, crowdfunding campaigns of all scales and sizes and goals and stuff. So I'm really excited to be here and share some of that experience with you guys.
Cool. My name is Sam Farmer, and I'm making a game called Last Light. It's a sci-fi noir adventure game that was Kickstarted back in May. And my story is I worked for 6 months before the Kickstarter, put it up. Immediately before I launched it, I got this amazing deal with Double Fine, where they agreed to help sort of publish and promote the game for me. So I launched it at PAX East, and then it went really well, better than I could have hoped. So now I'm actually making a game, which is the hard part after the hard part. So.
Yeah,
I'm really excited to talk to you guys about everything that you want to hear. So we don't have a real agenda or tell you this is how you do it, unless you ask us and tell us what you want to hear. And we'll get through that next.
Cool. I'm Scott Steffen, and this is Bryce Coe.
Yes.
And Leifu is back there too. And the three of us kickstarted a game called Aegis Defenders in August through September of this year. And we learned many painful lessons. You always say they weren't painful. I think they were painful. But yeah, we're excited to share it with you guys. And let's jump in.
I can start since I just launched one yesterday, so it's pretty fresh for me. Still fresh. It's pre-production is probably one of the most important parts of the Kickstarter. That you're in many ways how your Kickstarter is going to do. And I say Kickstarter, I mean crowdfunding, but Kickstarter is just the pre-production really defines it before you launch it in many ways. It's about how prepared you are both mentally and as far as your materials go, and engaging your community and kind of getting your forces organized ahead of time is really, really important. When we first launched the Nevermind Kickstarter back in last spring, our community was much smaller. And we did a few things to prepare for that. We launched something called a Prefundia campaign, which is a pretty neat service where, let's say a couple months ahead of time, hey, I'm going to be launching my Kickstarter, a couple months from now would be December, although don't launch it in December near the holidays, it's the worst time to do it with this money, so pro tip there. But let's say that you knew you were going to launch in December anyway. set up a pre-funding account now, and then as people get interested in the project, you're talking to someone on the street, like, oh, that's cool, or maybe get some press love, you can direct them to there, and they can sign up for your project, and the minute that your Kickstarter campaign goes live, press a button, and everyone who signed up ahead of time will get an email saying, hey, the Kickstarter's up, and that's a really great way to capture that interest that comes before the Kickstarter happens. However, don't just rely on the pre-fundia. That's one mistake we made where we had, we were really lucky because we got, we were on Reddit for a day before Kickstarter, and that just kind of blew up everything in a great way. And so we got like a few thousand people sign up on pre-fundia. Nuts. Unfortunately, I think it broke them.
And, Reddit breaks everything.
Yeah. And only, and so we were like, oh man, we got these pre-fundia signups. This is going to be great. Launch day is going to be massive. And it was big, But not as big as we thought, because only like a quarter of the people who signed up actually got notified, we think. So that was a bummer. So, you know, you want to diversify too, so set up a MailChimp list or just a mailing list. I like MailChimp. And just direct people to that, kind of gather people as you're getting the word out and start reaching out to press.
As a side tip, you may not know it now, but once you start running the Kickstarter, you'll realize how many third-party services they try to, people will try to shuckle you. And some of them are helpful, like Promoter app is really helpful for tracking mentions of your game and articles. Some of them I haven't tried, but like, know that you will get that attention.
And there's a lot of traps to fall into as well. Right. Some of them are very convincing, but a lot of them are just scams that want to like take all your money.
Right.
So I would...
Or your time. Really.
Yeah, exactly. So like, even we launched like 24 hours ago, and I've gotten like 5 solicitations already. It's crazy. Yeah. So just be aware of that. But
I think our MailChimp was really helpful too, because we did a couple conferences before we launched the Kickstarter where we were able to show the game. So we did a small anime conference in San Diego called Anime Kanji that was kind of tiny, and I think we paid like $500 or something to show the game. And then we did Anime Expo, and we just had this thing where it was like, hey, if you sign up for the mailing list, we'll give you a poster. And people were like, oh, yeah, let me do that. But what really helped was, I think when we launched, we actually didn't have that many people on the mailing list. It was like 1,200 or so. But it was like 1,200 people who were really interested who were also going to tell their friends. It wasn't like 1,200 randos who were going to come in. Because later on, like, you could see that, like, when we got the Kotaku article, it was like 13,000 visits or something. But It was like nobody pledged out of those 13,000, and when they did, it was so much lower than everybody else that it was really important to find people who are passionate and engaged with the Aegis Defenders concept beforehand, because they were going to go out and evangelize for us. And so it's not always about numbers, it's about finding the quality of person that you think is going to...
That was definitely. Like in terms of building the community beforehand, we thought of various different ways to engage people, and like he was saying, going out and actually displaying the game at these conventions was, I think, really huge for us to starting that base of people. And then, like, you could actually see them on the forums actually posting and saying things like, "Oh, I met these guys at Anime Expo and they were really cool," or whatever. So like. You know, if you don't know anybody, that's one way to do it, is you just go out there and start showing it to people. Because, yeah, like many of you, we didn't know that many people in the press or anything like that, so it's one of the ways.
The other thing, too, is don't be afraid to start small as well. Again, if you know that you're going to be launching like in 2 months, and I wouldn't recommend launching a Kickstarter, like preparing for a Kickstarter in less than 2 months. Like 2 months even still might be not enough time to get as much as you want.
I thought it would be 2 months, but it turned out to be 6.
Yeah, exactly. Like it takes you longer than you think.
Yeah, I think we did. We were planning on like 3, and we ended up doing 5.
I also didn't have
actually, that's an interesting question.
Sure, that's true.
Right. So, like, how long were you guys working on the project before you started thinking about Kickstarter?
From the beginning.
From the beginning. So, you were ready within 3 or 4 months?
Meaning, when I came up with my idea for my project, I decided I was going to do it on Kickstarter and say, no.
Okay, well. Yeah, I think for us, it was actually more along the lines of like 9 to 10 months from when we first started the project. Created a prototype and were like, hey, this is really cool, this could go on Kickstarter, to actually preparing the Kickstarter. Like, that took a really long time for us because we just, well, we did so
different
much research.
Different things.
Yeah, yeah.
So, like, I did a backwards thing where I decided I was going to do this Kickstarter, and my time and my money would be best spent preparing that. So I had to like make a Kickstarter before I made a game.
There's
which
something
is weird.
Cool about that, though.
Oh, it's very cool.
But yeah, a lot of things really cool.
You do
about
cool
that.
Stuff with that.
And like you get to engage the people who are interested in your game from the very beginning, which is really great. You get that feedback right off of the bat, and you're able to make your project even better because you've had that direct conversation with the people who will be playing with it. That's so great to do early on, so that you know you don't build this project and then you put it out there and everyone's like, this is great, but we want to change this key thing, and then you're kind of stuck with the tough decision. Do we throw away half the work we've done, or do we pivot and make the game better? You should make the game better.
Can you talk a little bit more about your back, like coming to Kickstarter story too? Because I think it's also unique.
Sure. So after I graduated, never mind, I was my thesis, and so I graduated. And I was like, well, that was fun. And I went and I actually worked at Zynga for a year. Which totally blows people's mind because it's like, oh, I'm going to work on this biofeedback horror game, now I'm going to work on poker. But they had a Zynga.org thing that was really great and aligned with all my interests, and I really enjoyed it there. But because of a lot of the attention that Nevermind got in the festivals and from a number of different communities, Nevermind was really always where my heart was. So I was like, you know what, this is really what I want to be working on. So I left Zynga. It's like, okay, well, I have no idea how I'm going to make Nevermind and then take it from this thesis project to a full releaseable game. But I'll figure out something. And so we looked into a lot of different options, whether it's getting investors, whether it's getting a publisher. But we decided that crowdfunding was really the ideal option in many ways because again, you get the community involved, you get the people who are really interested, most interested in your game, making it with you, which is like the coolest thing ever. You're getting direct feedback, you're getting it's as a game designer, like rarely do you actually get to hear people who play your games at the end of the day. At least in old school, I guess now when you can do updates and everything is quicker. But you know, I first made games when you had to like put a cartridge out there. Once it's done, that's it. So being able to like dynamically interact and change the game based on the opinions is fantastic. And so it was just a win-win-win where we'll get hopefully get the funding needed to make the game happen and get all this great input as well. So that's why we decided to go with crowdfunding for Nevermind, and I don't regret that at all.
Good question. How many people here are sold on crowdfunding? They know they're going to do it. How many people here are debating it? I'm not sure yet. How many people here don't care?
I would just say, following up on what Aaron said about having sort of a transparent, open development process, that's a thing. I think this dovetails nicely with a bit about accountability, because it's a thing that you have to decide that you want to do, because you could be like, I'm going to take your money and then you disappear for a year and make you a game. But that's not the way it works, because even though these people are not legally buying equity or they're not legally buying a part of your company, they feel like they have. And so you essentially have to devote part of your time now to community management, because there's a lot of people who are waiting for the thing that you said you were going to make. And so that may not be appropriate for your development style or your game. So as much as Kickstarter is a funding platform, and yeah, you get money at the end, you also get 4,000 people who now feel like they can knock on your door at any time.
But like,
give me advice.
You should know that the contract you're signing, like the social contract you're signing with Kickstarter, and all the backers, is they're paying for your thing way early because they want to be part of the process. It's not because it's different for every person that backs your game, which is another thing that we haven't talked about, but you'll have multiple audiences. Some people want it for you, some people they like you, some people like your game, some people like the idea behind your game, they like the genre of your game, they like mixes of these things, and catering to all of those people in all of your messaging is really challenging.
Yeah.
But before we get into the post-Kickstarter, like, following up, do we want to talk about the video?
Yeah.
A little bit? The page, maybe?
I feel like we have wildly different opinions.
Great.
Yeah. Exciting.
Start.
Something that we decided really early on was that the video was essentially a commercial for the rest of the page, and that if you didn't like the video, or if it was boring, you were probably not going to pledge, and you certainly weren't going to look at the rest of our content. And so in doing that, people are going to disagree with what I'm about to say, but we strongly don't like talking head videos where there's somebody that's like, my name is Joe Stevens and this is my game. Because there's like a 98% chance that unless you're like Miyamoto or Molyneux or somebody, like, your game is 100 times more interesting than you are.
Right.
Just because people don't know you, they don't know anything about you. Like, tell me about yourself later, tell me about yourself later on the page. Like, we very clearly, when we were building the video, did kind of like an arc in that video that was like, it's 2 minutes, and it ended up being like 2 minutes, 30 seconds, but like, if this is gonna happen, then it's gonna be this emotional moment, that's gonna get exciting, and there was really that intention from the beginning.
Right, and in terms of like, what the content we were showing, we had like a playable demo done, like I said, like 9 months earlier than when we started. But our video, we still basically had to storyboard out every single shot that we were gonna have in the trailer, and a lot of that content didn't exist yet. So part of our development time was like actually making it happen.
Yeah.
And so like, for us, pre-production largely was building that trailer and making that trailer as slick and, you know, eye-popping as we could to get people's attention.
And then we ended up actually not offering the demo publicly, because it was this thing where we thought that we built this idea of the game in that trailer that was like so fantastic and exciting, and we didn't want to put out a demo that was like, no, your idea of the game is wrong, this is what it actually is. You know, we're still confident that the game is going to be really good, but we didn't want to step on this imaginary product that people had built in their heads.
Right.
And the demo is totally out there, and if you send us an email, we're happy to give it to you. Like, I'm not afraid to show it to somebody, but it was just this thing where we had communicated one thing in the video, and I didn't want to contradict it with the actual product.
So just quickly, were you then being kind of a vertical slice for your trailer, essentially, like showing a lot of different types of content?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
And one thing we learned in talking to other teams is that a lot of the content that you'll see in Kickstarter videos, and this is true for us too, is incomplete, or like in our video, if you were to walk like 10 pixels like off of the screen where the video shot, like there's nothing there, right? And I'm not gonna name names, but like talking to other Kickstarter trailers, like famous ones that you have seen, if you go 10 pixels off the screen, like that's not there. Or they like animated the whole video in Flash, it's not in a game engine. So we built a lot of content exclusively for the trailer that will probably show up in the game, maybe in a different format. But, don't be afraid to do that if you think it's gonna help. And if you're confident that you'll be able to finish it.
Yeah, in regards to the demo, we talked to a lot of other Kickstarters beforehand saying like, oh, how important is having a playable demo for people? And what we saw through actual practice is that some games had amazing trailers and amazing Kickstarter pages, but their demos weren't solid enough, right? And so I think it actually was to their detriment to offer that playable demo when it didn't live up to the expectations they set. So that's a really tricky territory, because like, we were really confident in our demo that it was a fun game, but because we believed our trailer was still gonna like be more of a hard sell in terms of them being like, oh, I'm ready to like jump in, we just had to make the decision to hold it back and only use it to give to press and other venues like that.
So Kickstarter, what you're doing is you're putting out there this idea for what the game will become. So of course you don't have like footage of it because it hasn't been made yet. That's why you're running Kickstarter in the first place. So, you know, it may seem a little sneaky to like, you know, say like, oh, we'll just, you know, doctor the trailer to show. But like, that's not what you're doing. What you're doing is you're showing what your vision for it is, you know, and that's what you really want to put out there and get people excited about. So if you have a demo and the demo contradicts what that vision is, the demo doesn't really show the vision in the full degree you want it to be, just because you don't have the resources to take it there, which again is why you're writing the Kickstarter, then present it another way, whether that's through animatics or, you know, art or, you know, whatever makes the most sense for your game, for sure.
Good question, but
Would you say it's more difficult to sell a dream without having something concrete to show, or like it's not? I don't think it's black or white, you know?
I have an opinion on this matter.
Yeah. Well, you want to show something, like, to show your people and your crowd that you have something actually ongoing, but if it's not over, then it might give a wrong perspective, mm-hmm. because it's not expressing your vision yet, but what's your opinion on that?
Okay, so I'm going to be the one that dissents against everyone else.
Go for it.
But you guys said a lot of things, so I have to now address them all. You don't need a demo if your trailer is flashy enough, if your Kickstarter page is incredible enough, or if you have a following. If you're a nobody, if you've got nobody that cares about your game that's going to be able to spread the word, a demo is really helpful because it proves that even though you don't have that history, that you can make something great. Okay, demo out of the way. I faked my entire trailer. The whole thing was made in Cinema 4D. It was animated by me using some Mixamo mocap animations. And I did this because it was supposed to be a cinematic experience. And I had a limited time and a limited budget. And I knew that I could make it all in Unity. So it wasn't a question of, can I do it? I've made a lot of Unity games. It was a question of time. And I am fine with breaking rules as long as I'm able to, fill it later. So
yeah, I mean, I guess there's an ethics question there that's don't overpromise. Like, everything we put in our demo actually runs in the game engine, but we also knew, we can do this. We need more time, we need more money, but we can do this. It wasn't it was a section that was in 3D, and it was a realistic space sim. We didn't promise that, right? So, only promise what you can deliver, even if you are just kind of, another question.
I just want to ask, because you say about the demo, if you're a nobody, a demo's going to help, which I agree with, of course. But because you didn't have a demo, how big of a following did you have?
So, this is a complicated answer to a simple question. I did make a demo in Unity after I made my trailer. Okay. So, I made my trailer and I was like, yeah, this thing's awesome. And then I was like, but I need to prove to myself that I can actually make this first before I can put it on Kickstarter. Because, maybe people won't believe me, but more importantly, I need to believe myself that I can actually produce what I'm claiming.
Right.
So I made a demo level, and it turned out to be pretty good. So I decided not to actually release that demo. Instead, I decided to just film a playthrough of it, which I thought, people don't necessarily want to download something and go through it, especially if it doesn't have a tutorial. But they might be willing to launch a playthrough of it if it correctly expresses the game in the best light. Now, the second half of your question, why didn't I put a demo out if I was a nobody? I considered it, but fate intervened. And right as I was about to post the Kickstarter, a week before, I got this amazing found this amazing tweet from Double Fine saying that they were looking to start a new indie initiative, and if you had a cool game, you should send it to them. So I sent them an email, and then we started to work out a deal where they could publish and promote the game. So I didn't need it as much. And I didn't want to shatter people's expectation. But I think I made a mistake, because I actually held off putting the video of the gameplay up until later. And you need a lot of content when you're doing a Kickstarter, to release over time. And I thought that by having that, it would make it seem like work had been done. And also it would be kind of a gradual revealing of what the game is really about. But I think you should really put that stuff out at the front, because you're going to get so much traffic on that first few days. It's a shame to not have them see the whole thing.
And I remember, the week before we launched that Kickstarter, I was working on it day and night. I had gotten no sleep, and there was one point where I was so exhausted that my husband pried me away from my computer. He was like, "You gotta eat dinner." I was like, "Fine, give me a plate of spaghetti." And I fell asleep in the plate of spaghetti. It was Saturday morning cartoon style, the most bizarre thing. You wake up and you're like, "What?" You have so much stuff going on when you're preparing for Kickstarter that you don't want to be burning time doing something that you're not that great at, because it's not going to turn out great no matter what, and you're going to invest way too much time and energy into it. So what we did for this Kickstarter is we had someone do the filming and the editing and everything, and it was the best decision I think I made, because it looks way better than the old one, and it took me about 4 hours total as opposed to 100 hours total. So, and whether that's if you're great at editing, great, but there might be something else that you might need help with, community management or graphic design for the page or whatever the case may be, copy editing. Figure out what your weakness is and don't let someone else worry about it for you.
Question? So
kind of going off of what you said, so like, say I didn't really have the skill set or the tools to create like a trailer, and I don't know if I have, I could possibly get the money to try and hire someone else, and I don't know someone else. What should I be doing? Should I be borrowing money from friends and going to try and hire people to do this for me, or should I just like stick with it?
Question. I would say, I mean, if you know anyone who has some editing skills, like, you know, it doesn't have to be, depending on what you're trying to put in your video, you know, you can make a really good Kickstarter video just with very simple footage. You know, it doesn't need to be too flashy. So if you know someone who has basic editing skills, you know, see if they can help you out with it, or minimally, like, give you a tutorial on how to do it well, and try to, you know, at least learn everything you can so that you're not, you know, learning from scratch when you're doing it.
I also think it depends on how much money you're asking for. So if you're asking for like $100,000, that video could already be really, really good. If you're asking for like $5,000, it can probably be less good. But we saw, I mean, the bar for Kickstarter funding has gotten so much higher. Just like the quality of Kickstarter assets and production of people, the amount of time and money people are putting into it, has gotten so much higher that even just during our Kickstarter, like even just during that month, there were amazing games that were just like not funding left and right, and I was like, I don't know why this is happening. Like, there's no reason why these games should be not funding. But I really think it's a question of how much money they're asking for.
Yeah. I think like a scrappy startup, just really rely on your friends.
Yeah.
Right. Make those friends if you don't have them.
Yeah, we had Brian was helping us during the Kickstarter, and Bryce's girlfriend, and Lawrence. And, so they were like a rotating cast of like friends and family who were also pitching in. And
one other thing that can be very helpful, I know we're running out of time, so we need to move on, but you know, one thing that you have to offer is contingency. So I don't necessarily recommend it because it's not the best way to work, but it is great if you're in a pinch where you say, like, hey, you know, I can't pay you now, but if the Kickstarter is successful, then I can pay you this much, you know. And then that's great because, you know, it's you everyone's in it together, you know, and in many ways, you know, that the person has, you know, they're motivated to make it as best as possible too. So that's something, don't be shy about saying if you can negotiate a deal on that as well. And, you know, maybe with some, even like, you know, your local university, if there's like cinema students there, you know, ask and see if any of them are willing to put in some time, you know. But do a little bit creative about it and just kind of do whatever you can to get it done.
We should probably move on. Yeah, I didn't just mean to leave it there. Sorry. Yeah, right. Done. We could talk about the ask, like how much you're asking for. Do you want to know about that? Or,
I would say we should talk about the words a little bit and press a little bit and then maybe questions. Cause
fair enough.
I feel like those are the things people have most questions about, or that were mysterious to us. You can feel free to contradict me on that. I would say rewards are really, really tricky. The only sort of golden rule that we had about rewards was that anything that we were shipping under $100 was going to fit in a media mail envelope, which is like the cheapest way to ship something. It's like $2.26 these days or something. So,
you don't have the international problem either.
Well, we ended up doing some international shipping that was like just at $20 because that sounds about right. we're going to have to.
All right.
Actually, not that many, thank God. But we really limited the number of physical items that we were doing, and we knew what they were going to cost us. And when we were printing things, we were actually offering them maybe a little lower than we thought we were going to, because if you print a lot of them, they get much, much cheaper. Mm-hmm. Which is hilarious. It's like, to print one, it's $1,000, and to print, like, 1,000, it's like $1,001. Like, there's just a lot of money you pay to get someone to set up the screen or whatever. So that was kind of our golden rule, was to know exactly what things are going to cost and keep that around a percentage of that tier.
The margin sheet.
Yeah.
So, like, when you're deciding on, I think a gentleman over here was talking about doing mostly digital, like, that is absolutely what you should strive to do. And I see a lot of Kickstarters having physical rewards at really low tiers and saying, oh, well, you know, if I make $5,000, it's only going to cost me, like, $500 to do this. And it's like, well, there's so much more that goes into to it that, like, I think you were talking about with another Kickstarter, they spent the next, like, 3 months after the Kickstarter funded, just making the actual, like, goods, right? And that's definitely going to destroy your schedule. So
yeah, it's like, I always see t-shirts at low bars because people feel like, oh, I should only pay $9 for a t-shirt. But, like, the t-shirt's going to cost you, if you want it to be reasonable, like, $8 or $9 to print, and then it's going to cost you another $4 to ship it. Like, it's actually one of the most expensive things you can probably produce and ship.
So much more.
I think the key is that you're not, like, a production company making physical goods. You're trying to make, in this case, probably a video game, and that's what you should be spending all your time doing. So any physical good should be as easy as possible and as cheap as possible.
And make sure they're the ones that are going to benefit the project, too. You know, with our current Kickstarter, we have a lot of concept art-based physical goods, which is great because we needed a lot of concept art anyway, so it's a win-win. You know, it's like, we're going to be making this art anyway, so if you guys want to share in it, then it's all the better for everyone involved. So, like, don't put in a you know, something that's just going to be a pain and doesn't relate to anything else. I'm trying to think of an example, but...
Well, this is like the Octodad guys did like Octodad plushies, which was really fun, but then they spent forever like making them and shipping them.
Exactly. The plushies are, that's a good example. Yeah. They have to store all these plushies somewhere, and then, that's a good example.
Max Temkins considered just to make the plushies.
Yeah, exactly.
Max Temkins, one of the creators of Cards Against Humanity, is an austere minimalist, and his Kickstarters, he's done a few of them now, they only have like one tier, which is the product, which is so awesome, and I would be terrified to do. But like, I talked with him, and he made a lot of really good points that are contentious, right? So there's no like one right way. But his point is, if you have a bunch of different reward tiers, you're just going to confuse people, and that's going to turn more people away than it will actually make you money. Or maybe it'll make you that money, but then you have a smaller community, and that's not really what you want when you release the game. So strive for like the smallest possible.
But the other thing there is that like if you're Max Temkin and you've made Cards Against Humanity, you can probably get away with having one reward tier, but for us it was like, we need to convince you that $75 is an appropriate amount to spend on this game. Like, and that's a harder bar to reach.
I guess I built up like an emotional resistance to adding new tiers. So I was like, three tiers, that's what I wanted to do, just three tiers. And I was like, oh, I have to add a fourth tier, because there's like too much of a gap between these two. And then like halfway through the project, I was like, fine, I'll add a fifth tier. But I think that overall that benefited the project, because by the end of it, when people were coming in, they didn't see like a bunch of things, some of which were like, already taken because, you know, it's limited orders, and then, like, some of which were, you guys did that, but it's...
It gets complicated for you, too, because you have to keep in your mind, like, wait, what am I doing for this tier, and even after so many iterations that you don't know what's offering what. Simpler is always better. From the current Kickstarter, that was one big change we made from the last one, was that we had less tiers. We added add-ons, though, which I'm still not sure if that was a good idea or not. Well, as time will tell.
Fuck
add-ons. Yeah, I mean, like, it's good in a way because we got a lot of people who are like, well, I want this and this. I want something from column A and column B. And we want to be able to accommodate everything and be as flexible as possible. But add-ons are so complicated. Even when I back projects and there's add-ons there, like, I have to do the math, and then it's like, it's tricky. And so it's really, I don't know if they're good or bad. I can't say yet if that was a good decision or a poor decision. But, I mean, it's risky because you're asking someone's like, well, you know, back, you know, something at the $20 tier, but throw on an extra $75, and not like, you know, mark that as a reward. You know, we'll get back to you on that. You know, it's a very, it requires a lot of trust from the backer. You know, and that's a tough ask.
I think one of the issues with add-ons that I think is a more broad issue with like decisions on Kickstarter in general is like, it may seem like a little thing when you just focus on that issue. Like, yeah, I can handle add-ons. We won't add more than like five. I can fit those numbers in my head. But then when you realize that you have to deal with the taxes and the failed payments and fulfillment and writing updates and making the game, just think holistically about how much energy you have and really be careful with how you divide it.
And add-ons to, I mean, so that adds into the vocal minority thing where, like,
we had a million people being like, you gotta do add-ons, you gotta do add-ons, you gotta do add-ons. So we were like, here's add-ons, and we made like $100. It was like three people who kept talking and said something about add-ons.
When you add a tier on Kickstarter, you can't remove it.
Yeah.
That's a scary thing. Yeah. So that.
And the other add-on thing too is like when you're done, you just get these big like CSV spreadsheets from Kickstarter, and they're sorted by the reward level people chose. But in our case, like we have 4,000 backers, and so I'm like combing through this spreadsheet of 4,000 people looking for where the total doesn't match up to the reward, and like trying to pick them up and figure out which add-on. It's just it's extra time, which is fine because I have that time.
One thing that was highly recommended to us, and we're probably going to use again, we did it in a meeting at last week. Goal, but hopefully we'll need it this time, is BackerKit. It's a service that takes, I forgot what it numbers works out.
There's different pricing.
Yeah, it's like 3 or 5% or something, I think it sounds high, maybe 1% of your total funds, and then they'll organize all that stuff for you and make the add-ons process really easy for both you and the user. It saves you a lot of time. So and that goes back to something that was said earlier, where there's the hard cost of things, but it's also the time cost of things. And do not undervalue your time, because I think that's a mistake that I know I've made a lot, and I think a lot of people make, and it has a big impact. So if there's things like BackerKit that's going to save you time from like combing through things and dealing with all the nonsense, like just do it. Like it's totally worth it.
But also thinking about your budget, like for us, we weren't doing that much physical stuff, and we knew we weren't going to do that many add-ons, so it was like 3% of our total funds, I was like, I will just pay myself that money.
Yeah,
exactly. It depends on what your situation is, of course.
This is not fun stuff to talk about.
Going back to thinking holistically.
But one thing I wanted to talk about that I think is really important for people is like the cross-promotion element between other Kickstarters. Because one of the things that you'll learn when you do a Kickstarter is that Kickstarter backers, the actual people who do the backing, are kind of like a different breed of people. And You'll reach, like, let's say you get a Kotaku article or you get an article on Polygon or whatever, you might get thousands, hundreds of thousands of views on those articles, but it might not actually translate into actual sales. And what is way more effective is cross-promoting with another Kickstarter who has, you know, a massive, maybe just a few thousand people, but they actually back Kickstarters. And I think that also has to do with what we were saying earlier about, you know, there's going to be these local minorities saying these things, but it's not that many people. But some of these Kickstarter people are just a little bit different.
And they would all know each other, too, in the comments. They'd be like, oh, Diego, you're here, too.
Yeah. So true.
Yeah.
It's like a personal message board for them.
Yeah, it really is.
It is.
That's a
very good question.
Valid question.
So I'll try to explain it, and correct me if I can totally be confusing about it. Yeah, exactly, yeah.
All right. What are add-ons?
What?
What are add-ons?
Okay, so basically you say, like, here are your tiers, you know, $20 you get this bundle, $30 you get this bundle. And then add-ons is like, well, if you add on $15, so instead of pledging $20, you pledge $35, but you only take the $20 reward. Then when the Kickstarter goes through, we will see that you put in $15, which is the amount that goes towards a t-shirt, and we'll add a t-shirt in there. So it's like this weird...
It sounds like math. It is
black magic math thing that is really way more complicated than it should be, but it is. And that's what it is. It's just like, here are extra things that you can add on to your pledge, and then at the end of the thing, we'll figure out the difference and we'll...
And you should decide if you want to do add-ons, because we very early on were like, we're not doing add-ons, and so we priced things in a way that made them not very add-on compatible. Like, for example, our art book, like the way it's priced in the Kickstarter, is probably worth like $75 or something, but then like when you put that on the add-on and it's like, add an art book for $75, people are like, fuck you, and then it's like, we just didn't think about that enough to, so if you are thinking that you want to do add-ons, make sure that you incorporate that into your tier pricing process.
I think the trouble with add-ons is then you'll start thinking about your Kickstarter as a store. You know what I mean? Like, I'm selling shirts for $15 if you add on $15. And like we were saying earlier, you don't really want to worry about that stuff.
Right, just open up a store.
Right, exactly.
Where I've seen add-ons work really beautifully is in board games, where people are like, hey, add on $15 to get plastic tokens instead of paper ones. Right. And there's an upgrade process there that works really nicely.
That's all fulfillment, so those guys have to deal with that stuff anyway.
Right, yeah.
So,
yeah.
There's a really important thing we haven't talked about.
What is that?
And that has to do with the ask. The most important advice I ever got was just at a PAX talk after I watched the Kickstarter. Never ask for too little. ever. Because if you make that, but not like by a lot, then you have to deliver on this thing. You can't afford to. So.
In my opinion, failing a Kickstarter is not getting funded. Failing a Kickstarter is getting funded, but not enough. You know, then you're screwed. What are you going to do? You know, and that's something that I've heard a lot of conflicting data about. I don't know if you guys have as well. Like, some people adamantly say, like, make your goal small. Make it small so that you hit it in the first day, and then you build all this momentum, and then you'll luckily double it. And that, you may have a higher chance of doing that, maybe, but it is a risky gamble to take, and I don't think anyone needs that stress, and no one wants to be in that position of not being able to deliver.
Yeah, I do have one point to say on that, though. If you have another source of funding, if you're not relying solely on Kickstarter,
sure,
then it may make sense to go from another level.
Right.
And use it primarily as a promotional channel for your
show.
Exactly.
Your
That's
exactly,
exactly
what
we
yeah.
did.
Yeah.
Make sure you can finish your game.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah, we basically like had our budget number, and then we were like, well, this feature is going to take $20,000. So take that out, reduce the ask by $20,000, make it a stretch goal. And we were also willing to put our own money in. Bryce was willing to put his own money in. to kind of make those ends meet if we didn't meet our goal.
Right, and that should be your safety if you want to lower your ask.
Yeah.
But don't rely on that too much, because Kickstarter takes a good chunk out of that. So
right.
It's not like, oh, I'll just put this money in and I'll get it back. No, you're going to get that back less. 10%.
Oh, super important. Yeah, you're going to lose 10%. You're going to lose between, what is it, like 8 and 12%, depending on what credit cards people use and all the stuff. So that money's going to disappear immediately, and then you're going to pay your state and federal taxes on that money, because it's income. Like, if you're a business, or God forbid, if you're a person, that money comes into your bank account, and that's income, and you pay taxes on that income.
Yeah,
and so it's like...
an accountant.
Start a small business. Depends on the size of your Kickstarter, but if it's over what, 50 grand, start a small business.
Yeah.
Okay.
There are lots of questions. We'll just go.
Yeah.
Around. Okay. Start.
Would you say that the ability of raising the funds is directly proportional to the amount of money that you are trying to raise? Or is it more of the
exponential?
Or
I would say it's exponential. Like, the less funded a game is, the less likely other people are to fund it, which is what she was saying with, like, as soon as it gets funded, it's way easier to get overfunded, but it's just, you don't want to fall into that trap, because you might just barely make your goal, and then everybody's screwed, because you can't actually make it. You know?
It's so bizarre, this phenomenon, where a lot of people won't back your project until it's funded, which I don't understand.
Oh, they want to back successes.
I get that, but it's like, it's so weird, because it's like, well, that's the whole thing, is that you're a part of making this happen, so it's not... Yeah, it's just this weird, and there's a lot of weird psychology with crowdfunding. That's just like one of the many things where it's like, really?
As we approached our like $65,000 goal, people were like backing out like crazy. They were like, oh shoot, I'm actually gonna have to actually pay for this. Like, as we were approaching, it was like we would get $100 and lose $100, and we'd get $500 and lose $200, and it's just like, it was this uphill battle to make that $5,000.
Yeah, there's strange people backing Kickstarters.
And then it was fine, but it was like getting that number, like, people were like, oh no, I'm gonna have to pay.
Because I think different genres attract different customers. And they have different, you know, disposable incomes, and they might.
Wait, how does that work? If it breaks the number, does that mean everybody's locked in or not?
No,
it just means like when the campaign actually closes.
I mean, I was just thinking like as the Kickstarter runner, you could just be like, oh, I'm just gonna throw out my own 200 to put it over the.
Oh yeah, you can totally do that. But then you're gonna lose 10% and then pay taxes. It was like we had family members who were like, I want to put in $2,000. And it was like, great, wait until the Kickstarter's over.
Yeah.
Right, and check, because otherwise it's like buying an ad or something.
Next question. Yes.
So, I'm curious how you set a realistic target for your projects, because like, depending on your kind of built-in audience and the level of marketing proficiency you may have, that could be very different.
Right. I think that's a really tricky subject, because I think some games that have, it really depends on the genre, because some games that have a built-in audience, there's a lot of people who want to play a game that they've already played before and are willing to pay money for that. But if you have like a new genre of game and it's kind of untested, even if it's really cool, there's just going to be less people who are going to give you that money. So, I mean, at the end of the day, you're doing Kickstarter probably to pursue a dream. So I would say you just kind of have to go with that and realize that if you don't have a built-in audience around the genre that you're going for, it's going to be harder.
I would also say, like, do your budget. Take an afternoon, take two afternoons.
What do you use?
Sit down. We just, like, a Google spreadsheet and just listed every one of our expenses and realized that it was a terrifying number that was, like, three times as much as we thought. And then you take that number and, like, double it because let's be realistic. But it was a really big eye-opener because we realized, oh, this game's going to be really big, and we actually made way more money than we thought. So, like, just take an afternoon, be as honest as you can be. Sit there and Google stuff. If you don't know how much health insurance is, like, look it up, because that number's a lot bigger than you think.
I use You Need a Budget.
Oh,
it's
yeah.
a great
yeah.
piece of software. It's, like, free for 30 days or something. Check it out. Whenever I get stressed, I go back to my budget because it'll, like, soothe me, because I'm like, okay, I got this much time, okay. Because, like, money is time in Kickstarter world, right? So you just think, like, can I deliver in this much time?
And I've talked to other industry folks, too, and we have connections to kind of like check some of your numbers as well. Because some things you just don't know because you haven't done it, you know? Like, you know, for example, for our current Kickstarter, we're hoping that we're going to develop for Xbox One if it gets funded. I haven't developed an Xbox One game before, so I was like, well, I'm not sure. So I spoke to, you know, people I know who have, and then like, what are we looking at for costs? What are some of the pitfalls? What, you know, how much do I need to buffer this? And that was super helpful. So definitely get as many pairs of eyes on it as you can. Okay, next questions.
John.
Oh yeah, I know. So you kind of mentioned this a little bit about, you know, pre-Kickstarter going to conferences and trying to get people to know about your game. I know you're running out of time, but can you talk a little bit about what you do during the Kickstarter campaign to try to continually drive traffic to it besides spamming all of the social networks and begging people or sitting there biting your nails watching that happen?
I think this has a lot to do with the pre-production side of it, which is that you have to have this store cache of content that people actually are going to get value out of when they look at it. So one of the things that we did was we actually planned what those updates would be, so there'd be like a mini trailer for some portion of the game. There's going to be a live stream in which, you know, I'm doing concept art or whatever. Like, you actually have to have something to bring to the table to get people involved. That's kind of it.
Yeah, and I think for sort of getting attention and press, like, we didn't know anything about that. I was like, I guess we'll just email them 400 times until they answer us. And that was really the thing, because, like, they get a lot of email, and so I just had to bother them. And that was the most time-consuming and painful part of the process. Oh man, that's a whole other talk. Like, so we actually, the subject line was such a problem for us, and we've never figured it out, but we got way more responses from a Miyazaki-inspired 16-bit tactical platformer than we did from, like, our tower defense-inspired thing. Like, evoking some kind of, like, aesthetic or emotion in that subject line got us way more attention than trying to, like, describe what was cool about the mechanics.
Yeah. Use a picture or a GIF if you want.
Yeah. Moving. Yeah, get those GIF GIFs up there.
So there's, like, a lot of perseverance involved with just spamming these people, basically. But, I mean, obviously, you want to come off as genuine as possible. But what's kind of interesting is as soon as one of them picks you up, like, I think it was Anesthetic or something, they all kind of start piggybacking on top of each other. So just know that, like, that's part of it as well. It's not just, like, going to be an uphill battle the entire way.
Twitter's really good for that, too. We would, like, email people and then poke them on Twitter and be like, hey, I emailed you, just so there's, like, this, like, direct contact.
Public contact.
But that's just time. Like, that's the thing that's most
tiring. Just time.
And I'm sure you guys experienced this too. Like, when we got to the end, we just kind of dropped the ball. Like, we had that Shovel Knight trailer that nobody saw because we were like, I can't send another email. We just kind of dropped the ball.
You're really dead. And you're so tired of people asking, what was your inspiration? You have to keep coming up with new stuff.
Yeah,
or else
you can't just cut and paste the answers, even though.
And the other reason the video is important is that, like, nobody will read your body copy. I actually went back and crunched the numbers for a talk, and it was something like 76% of, like, the questions and emails and contact forms and Kickstarter messages were for things that were answered in the body.
Oh, yeah.
of the
but
Kickstarter.
People won't watch more than 30 seconds of your movie, too. So, like, make sure you just, like, data load the front of it, and then,
yeah. I forgot to mention, but talking, okay, I don't want to go back too far, but I used to Talking Head. I heard the Kickstarter actually likes it when you put their face in it.
Oh, they love it.
And they're more willing to, like, promote you. So there's definitely like some promotion that you can get out of Kickstarter, which we haven't talked about at all. And we're just talking about something advertising. Most of the people that cover your game, that are going to cover your game in the first week. And then a lot of the coverage you're going to get at the end are people that have already covered it wrapping up the story. So make sure that opening is really good. And then spend the middle time, you know, like working with your community, like get to know them, but like not freaking out, because most of the work you did was in pre-production. It's already on the page.
Yeah.
I think people freak out about how much content they should be producing for their community, but it's like, it's okay. And then focus on that end game. Like, what are your interviews going to be? How are you going to get people excited again?
When did you guys start reaching out to the press? I'm interested, because we originally started a month before, and they were all like, well, just send us a link again when your Kickstarter is actually live. And it's like, no, I want you to promise to do this. So, I mean, it actually maybe didn't make sense for us to start until like a week before. It's just everybody else was like, well, just contact me later. I mean, it was helpful to have those emails to then bother them directly, but...
We have like different views on that part, because to me, I didn't want to launch a Kickstarter until we had guaranteed at least one solid website was going to cover us, because I was just so worried about the opening day. But then looking back on it, I'm curious how you guys experienced this. I don't feel like press actually translated to more than 10% of our sales. Like, it really, maybe 15.
That's a good question.
Yeah, I think there's more for me. It's really hard to tell. Kickstarter says that you have X number of direct links. Mm-hmm. So they'd actually tell you where the thing's coming from.
Right.
But direct links, like, you don't know where that's coming from. And the next highest was Twitter, then The Verge, Rock, Paper, Shotgun, Kotaku, and then everything else.
Interesting.
That helps.
We have, like, very different statistics.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah?
Extremely different.
I feel like... But it's hard to say, too, because, like, so a lot of our referrals came from, like, Twitter or Facebook or whatever, but it may have been someone who saw it on Kotaku and then saw their friend mention it and was like, oh, that's a real thing, my friend now says it's cool, let me go back. So I don't think you can, like, not do press, but
yeah,
at least
yeah.
for us, like, our direct from press links were just almost non-existent. We were a big word of mouth.
And the other thing I wanted to mention was I had a mandate for myself that I was going to make a video less than a minute. Because I never watched more than a minute of any video.
It's a good target, yeah.
Shorter is better.
Way better.
I think we aimed for 90 seconds and did it up at 2 minutes and 30. But but yeah, shorter is better. Nobody watches the whole thing.
Quick question on the tax thing. I mean, if your project, if you can expense a lot of your costs in the same like tax year that you get for your funds, wouldn't that reduce the amount of tax you have to pay out for?
Yes, that's a question for Glenn Schwent, CPA. But there's a certain amount you can write off, which is great. But there's also, there's something just because it's just income, like you just end up paying a certain amount, and it's a lot.
I've heard a lot of horror stories of people like either underestimating how many taxes they're going to pay or did it wrong and got in trouble. I can't stress enough the power of a really good account. Totally.
And accounts aren't that expensive. I always thought they were going to be really expensive, and we talked to this guy, and he was like, "It's going, you know, it was like not that much money."
Whatever your budget is, basically you're doubling it, and don't like shortchange yourself. Be like, I can get away with like, you know, really just double it.
Or be like, I can eat ramen for a year because you can't. Not so much. And if one day you're going to break and you're going to go to Whole Foods and spend your entire budget, like this is be aware of your capacity because it's. It will take everything out of
it. Yeah. Kickstarter is totally a mental game in many ways.
Yeah.
It's a long form.
How much of your time was spent? I know mileage may vary and then there's services that you guys mentioned, but how much of your time was spent managing Kickstarter during the campaign and then after the campaign?
I just wrote an update the other day. During the campaign, it's a full-time job. Make no mistake that, like, if you're not working on your campaign, you'll feel bad because you think you can be doing better if you work harder, which is not true. But it is, like, you have to be there to respond to people. You have to be, like, working on new content for your campaign.
Fires will come up, too. Like, oh, my God, this giant press person wrote this thing that's slightly inaccurate. Now I have to go and, you know, kind of fix that.
Yeah.
And those things come up all the time,
yeah.
And sometimes
that's
at 4 in the morning, and, you know.
Right.
It's speaking of press stuff too, so there's a period in your Kickstarter, your first like 3 days are going to be awesome, and your last 2 days are going to be awesome, and then everything in between is just like the graph just goes like this, and then like that. And there's just like this trough where nothing happens. And the only thing that worked for us in that trough in terms of moving the needle was like press from other similar Kickstarters that were kind of in the same genre that had funded really well or were kind of successful. Like, nothing else worked in there. It's just like a flat line, except for when Hartford Alicia gives a little shout out. There's like a spike on a Saturday.
The cross promotion of other Kickstarters
is
valuable.
Right. And that's the reason also why you don't want to necessarily run a really long campaign. Early on, when we were first looking at our first Kickstarter, I was like, well, why don't we just run it for the whole length? More time means more money, right? But no, you want to minimize that trough like as much as possible. You know, if you can run a 3-day Kickstarter, I would almost kind of recommend it. I don't recommend it, but like that
like
would
emotionally,
be,
you would recommend
emotionally, like I would recommend like a week long Kickstarter over a 40-day Kickstarter.
It
will
make
really
money you need.
Right. Yeah, no, yeah. I'm not recommending it for the record, but you want to minimize that. So that's why like 30 days is about the sweet spot, because it's enough time to get done what you need to get done, but it doesn't, it minimizes the pain. Also, you lose pledges in that time too. The longer Kickstarter goes, the more people are like, wait a minute, I want to buy a puppy instead. And they like take back their pledge and spend on other stuff. So you don't want to.
No puppy for you.
Yeah, exactly. I want them to buy puppies.
And it's also like some days are statistically better than other days. Like our Thursdays were atrocious. There was a day when we lost money, which I didn't know was possible. Some guy pulled out a really big pledge, and then it was just like, your total for the day, -$100. But Fridays were really good because people got paid, and that was observable in the numbers. Everything about when you're going to launch and when you're going to close, like, try to get some Fridays in there.
And also, I mean, along those lines, this goes into your Kickstarter psychology. You want to launch either on a Tuesday or a Wednesday, because that's when people are bored at work. Weekends will give you almost nothing. It's dead on weekends, so don't like, which is counterintuitive. I thought like everyone on the weekend is on their computer looking to spend money and stuff now. And you also exactly. So like, definitely do your research on that. And pay days also, be conscious of that. You know, so the 1st and 15th, or you want to make sure you get at least as many pay cycles in there as you can, because you definitely see a spike.
Another big one is avoiding like other big game events. So like if there's if E3 is happening during your campaign, your chances of getting press on your Kickstarter like are basically zero. So you have to plan out your Kickstarter those 30 days within a time slot where you're just going to minimize the number of things that are basically going to cover you up in terms of press. So
yeah, we had ours ended like that weekend of PAX, and it was like we had this dude, like this really big Kickstarter dude, who was like, I'll do it as soon as I get back on Wednesday. And we were like, no, it closes on Tuesday. And like, sure enough, he put up this thing on Wednesday. But like, just be aware of the fact that people are going to be busy or you might get stopped.
So you guys want to do final words?
Yeah.
I have one question. So Kickstarter seems to generally work really well for games, at least from what I've seen, with like sandbox games and stuff like that, because you can kind of like add a lot of content. But what about like a linear single-player game?
I decided from the beginning that my game is going to be episodic, so that I can make whatever I wanted to with the money that I had. Mm-hmm. And I decided that partially because Double Fine's Kickstarter was so successful, and then they decided to split it in half, and everyone was really upset. Yeah. But in an episodic game, you know, everyone knows what they're going to be signing on for, and you can work that to your advantage, basically, so that you can tell a coherent story with what you have. That's my recommendation. If it doesn't work for episodic, I don't have any advice for you.
Something like the single-player game is
pretty
good. Yeah, I mean, it's generally good practice. If you can make your game modular, then that's always a good thing on a number of levels. It makes game development a little bit more sanity-inducing. But especially for Kickstarter, like,
complicated too. It's better. Like, it helps with regards to expectations.
So,
this is the end. Thank you guys so much for coming to our session. It really means a lot to us that you're willing to listen to us for an hour. Kickstarter is a journey, and everyone says that, but what it really means is that, like, the people that go through it, that endure it, become kind of like an alumni group. And they feel a camaraderie with each other because they've all gone through this traumatic experience. Not to say that you have a bunch of negative stuff ahead of you, but with good, there's also bad. And hopefully, you will be able to take punches with the wind.
Yeah. Following up on that alumni thing, I'll show this goes for you guys too, but we're always open. If you email us, we'll hop on Skype with you. And that was a big help to us in the beginning. We talked to Yacht Club Games, and they completely changed our whole outlook on Kickstarter. So just shoot us an email. We're happy to talk to you. I'll be at the festival showing a different game for the next couple of days, so come find me. I'll be happy to talk about something other than
not in this alone.
Yeah.
And quick plug, just because it seems appropriate, we're running the Evermind Kickstarter. Feel free to. No pressure.
The art of promotion.
Never mind. Yeah.
Put in a bunch of money, then take it out after she's funded.